Good day and welcome to this Easter Sunday worship here at Faith United Methodist Church in Bradenton, Florida. My name is Gary Eldred, the pastor of Faith Church. It's a delight to welcome you to the service through our videotaping, and we are just so glad you could join us here as we celebrate Easter Sunday. It's a different Easter Sunday this year, of course, all around the world. People have to celebrate in a different way because of the COVID-19 epidemic, but that's okay, because as we celebrate Easter, we remember the promise that Jesus gave to us when he said, "I'm the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, though they die, yet shall they live." That's the promise that Jesus gives us, and that's why we celebrate every Sunday, but especially Easter Sunday. Let's pray. Let's pray. Oh God, bless this time. Bless each person who views and listens through videotape. We ask you to make this a special time of worship. We want to honor you in this way, and we seek your blessings in our lives as we worship you. We need your care and your direction, and we trust you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We want to share in a wonderful Easter hymn, "Up from the Grave He Arose."
G.T. Bray and found lots of eggs one other day this week. But no, we can't do that this year. But I brought a basket of eggs, And I want to talk about how I can tell the Easter story with these eggs. In the first egg, I have a cross. Jesus willingly carried a cross up the hill to Calvary because he wanted to be able to save us from our sins. In the second egg, I have three nails. The nails that were nailed into Jesus, of course, were much, much bigger than these. If you can imagine, they went into his hands and his feet. How much pain he had to suffer when these nails were put in him. After he died, he was taken down from the cross and taken to a new tomb. A large rock was rolled in front of the tomb because they were afraid somebody would come and steal the body. 3 days later, early in the morning, two women came to the grave because they had spices and oils to anoint the body. They found the stone rolled away, and they wept, thinking that somebody had come and taken Jesus away. But they walked into the tomb, and it was empty. "Where is their Lord?" they said. Then they saw two angels dressed in white. He said, "Where have you taken our Lord?" And they said, "Why are you weeping? Did you not hear him say that he would rise from the dead?" And that is what he did. The cross could not hold him down. The nails could not hold him down. The rock, the stone, could not hold him down. Our Jesus rose from the dead. Jesus is alive. He is alive.
Thank you.
Your suffering, your dying, but then the empty tomb. The joy the disciples felt, the women felt, all who saw you and heard you, and we ourselves are filled with joy as we understand that in you we have victory over death, and in you we have newness of life as we live our lives here on earth. So we praise you as the author of joy, as the author of the one who fills our hearts with hope and with an understanding that it will all come together with an explosion of joy, even as it was an explosion of joy there for the disciples and all who loved you and had followed you to see you alive again. So we praise you. And Lord, we lift up our world to you today. We know there are many in our world right now who don't have joy. We struggle under the COVID-19 pandemic. Many are sad because family members and friends have died. Many are sad because of sickness. It's just a struggle. We are all sad because our lives are just so different because of COVID-19. So we look to you for your blessings. We pray you'll help the scientists and the doctors, help our government officials. May your hand reach down from heaven and bless us. We just pray for this curve to flatten, the deaths and the new sicknesses. We seek your blessing, Lord, your care during this very, very difficult time. And we know, even in the midst of the difficulties, we can find joy in our relationship with you and in our relationship with one another, even though those relationships have to be distant relationships in so many ways. So we seek your blessing, we seek your care, we pray for Deborah Johnson's husband Bob, who's recovering from home after surgery this past week. We continue to pray for others in our church, Nancy Kaiser, Steve Summers, and others, Lord, who face issues of poor health other than COVID-19. But again, we pray for those who are struggling with the sickness. And just bless us, Lord. Bless all Christians everywhere as we have a wonderful opportunity to reach out in the name of Jesus and love our neighbors, care for those who are struggling, who are lonely, who need encouragement. So whether it's through a phone call or through a text message, whatever it may be, help us to encourage one another and care for those who are struggling. So Lord, hear our prayers today, our voices of joy as we celebrate your resurrection, we celebrate our own resurrection. And we pray as we've been taught by you, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we're going to share in Christ the Lord is risen today. To send in your offerings via snail mail or drop it off in the church office or go to our church website to send your offering, and you have responded overwhelmingly. Every Monday, Fred Mack and I meet to count and then deposit what money we've received during the past week so we can pay the church's expenses. We both have been blown away as the count continues to grow and exceeds our expectations. So thank you for remembering your church during this unbelievably difficult time. Now please don't let this go to your head and think you have done your part. Please continue to remember your church and send in your regular offering. Do not get behind in your giving because, after all, if you get behind, then the church gets behind, of course, in its meeting its bills. So we need your continuous support. Remember to pray daily for our church, our state, our country, and our world, that God will be with us and forgive our transgressions. We will get through this, but only with God's blessings. Again, note from Barb Munini, our treasurer.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. scriptural reading is Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 14. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples, and as he told you, and Peter, that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now after he rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out seven demons. She went out and told those who had been with him while they were mourning and weeping. But when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they would not believe it. After this, he appeared in another form to two of them as they were walking into the country. And they went back and told the rest, but they did not believe them. Later, he appeared to the 11 themselves as they were sitting on the table. And he upbraided them for their lack of faith and stubbornness, because they had not believed those who saw him.
Last Sunday, I shared with you how Peter just simply lost his nerve whenever Jesus was being questioned by Caiaphas, the Jewish high priest. We have to remember that Peter was Jesus' right-hand man. When Jesus had asked his disciples, who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? It was Peter who spoke up and said, "You are the Christ, you're the Messiah, you're the Son of God." And it was Peter who tried to keep Jesus from going to Jerusalem. Jesus kept talking about going to Jerusalem, being arrested, being tortured, being crucified. So Peter tried to protect his friend, Jesus. And of course, it was Peter who carried a sword with him in the Garden of Gethsemane. And when the men came to arrest Jesus, it was Peter who pulled the sword from his robe and severed the ear of one of the men who had come to arrest Jesus. But then there at Caiaphas' court, a little servant girl came and confronted Peter and said, "Ah, I recognize you. You're one of his disciples." "I don't know the guy. I had nothing to do with him." Peter lost his nerve. And then as Jesus was being taken from Caiaphas' court, he looked straight at Peter. And Peter just cringed inside because he remembered what Jesus had said to him, "Peter, you're going to deny having any identification with me before the rooster crows." And Peter remembered that. Peter went out and he wept and he cried greatly because the prophecy came true. And here he had betrayed his friend. So what do we do when we betray Jesus? What do we do when we say and live as though we just don't know him? What do we do when we basically unconfess Jesus? Instead of confessing Jesus, we unconfess him. When through our words, through our actions, through our attitudes, we simply lay aside our faith in him, refusing to recognize him and honor him as our Lord. The disciples were devastated by Jesus' death. They had put their hopes in him being the new King of the Jews, the Son of David, that he would be the ruler, he would rule the whole world from Jerusalem. He was dead. He was buried. He was gone. That was it. Kaput. Nothing. Nothing to the vision. Nothing to the dream. Jesus had welded the hearts of his disciples together. They were friends. And so they stayed together. They went back to the upper room where they had celebrated Passover with Jesus. They clung together. They were scared to death that the Romans were going to come after them and arrest them. Remember, it was Joseph of Arimathea who took Jesus down from the cross and put him in a tomb that Joseph had actually created for himself. It wasn't the disciples who took Jesus down from the cross. Remember, it was the women who had followed Jesus, not his disciples, who went out early in the morning to the tomb. They went for closure. They wanted to see this dead man one more time and anoint his body with spices. Remember, it was the women, not the disciples, who first heard the good news. He's risen from the dead. And it was to a woman that Jesus spoke the first to, Mary Magdalene, not to a disciple. Not to a disciple. They were cringing. They were hiding out. They were in that upper room. They were frightened. So we read in Scripture how Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome, they went to the tomb. They wondered how they were going to get to Jesus because they remembered there was a big, really big rock in front of the tomb. But they got there and the stone had been rolled away. They went inside and there was this angel dressed in white. He said, "Hey, he's risen. He said he would rise. What are you surprised about? What's the big deal here? What are you surprised about?" Because he said continually he would be crucified, but he would rise again. His body is not here. It's been raised up. He is not here. And then the angel said to the women, "Go tell his disciples," since they don't really have the guts to come here themselves, but go tell his disciples and Peter. Go tell his disciples and Peter that Jesus goes ahead of them into Galilee. The angel mentions Peter's name particularly. So why did he do that? Why did the angel make a big deal of mentioning Peter by name? I believe it's because Jesus wanted Peter to know particularly that he was still a part of his team. Jesus wanted Peter. Jesus wanted to see Peter. Jesus wanted Peter to know that in spite of what he had done, what he had said, in spite of all the shame and guilt that was in his heart and all that he was feeling, Jesus wanted Peter and all the disciples to continue to be his friend. And really, this is the message of the cross. And really the message of the empty tomb. Jesus wants to be our friend. He wants to be our friend. He wants us to be a part of his team. The church is Jesus' team in the world. He wants us to be a part of that. He wants us to know that no matter how much guilt or shame or remorse we have in our hearts, I want to be your friend. I want to be your savior. I want to walk with you through life because I love you. This is the message of the cross, that God wants us to be reconciled to him through his son. No matter how far we've wandered from God, from the ways of the Lord, God wants us to be reconciled. God so loved the what? The world. Everyone in the world, that he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believes in him shall not indeed perish, but have everlasting life. You see, we have to remember that Peter and Judas Iscariot were really in the same boat when Jesus died. They were in the same boat. They had both betrayed Jesus. But the important thing is how the two men dealt with what they were feeling, what they were thinking. The important thing is their response. Peter reunited himself with the other disciples. Crucial. So very crucial. In spite, again, what he was thinking, what he was feeling, and the other disciples knew what he had done. But Peter reunited with the other disciples. He heard the good news. Didn't believe it at first. None of them believed it. You know, and that was part of the culture back then. You didn't believe women, especially over something so fantastic as that. She saw something, but it wasn't what she really was really there. That was part of the culture back then, quite honestly. You didn't believe women. Men didn't believe women over anything important. But they shared the good news, and Peter was there to hear the good news. And he was there to hear Mary Magdalene and others say, you know, Peter, the angel mentioned you by name. That Jesus wants to particularly see you again. What did Judas do after he betrayed Jesus? Those 30 pieces of silver. What did Judas do? He failed to reunite himself with the other disciples, didn't he? He went his own separate way. He drew within himself. He tried to find within himself what he needed to cope with his guilt and his shame. He could not find it. It was not there. He couldn't find within himself what he needed to deal with his wretchedness. He was filled with so much hopelessness that he took his life. You see, the cross tells us, though we are forgiven people, as we look to Jesus for that forgiveness. That's the good news. We are forgiven. The empty tomb tells us that as Jesus came from that tomb, risen from the dead, with newness of life, we can have a new life with Jesus. We don't need to live a life burdened down by guilt and shame and remorse and fear and hopelessness and despair. We can find in Jesus new life. But we got to do that together. The Bible teaches, of course, that Jesus ascended back to heaven. His body ascended back to heaven. But the church is the body of Christ here on earth. And so, in our faith in Jesus, we must be with others who have faith in Jesus. We must walk with others because we are a body. We're a body. We need to look to one another to find the encouragement that we need to keep walking with Jesus, to keep trusting Jesus, experiencing his presence, his grace, and his mercy. We need to stick together. We need to stick together. See, Judas may have decided to live instead of die if he had reunited himself with the other disciples. But he took that solitary path to death. Anyone who fails to walk with Jesus and walk with others who believe in Jesus are slowly but surely killing themselves. Peter and the other disciples went on and they proclaimed the good news. Jesus appeared to them. He was with them. They shared the good news of Christ. And they really had two messages that were summed up in two short statements. First of all, he is risen. He's risen from the dead. This man was dead. I mean, the Romans said he was dead. The Jews said he was dead. Everybody said he was dead. He was dead. He didn't swoon or he didn't go unconscious or anything like that. The man was dead. But he's risen from the dead. And their other message was simply, He is Lord. He is Lord. Because He is risen, He is Lord. You see, the resurrection validated, proved, demonstrated that everything else that Jesus said, taught, preached, did, was true. Was true. That's the significance of the resurrection. It was a validation that everything He had ever done was true. You see, Jesus is not simply a teacher of truth. Jesus was and is truth. And it is truth, Jesus, who sets us free from all that would rob us of hope, joy, and peace. And there's a lot of stuff around us that wants to rob us of hope, joy, and peace, including something called COVID-19. There's just lots of stuff in the world that want to take from us what God wants us to possess. Truth frees us from self-destructive guilt and shame and hopelessness. Truth frees us to worship and serve the only one who can save us from hell here on earth and from hell after death. What did Jesus say? I am the way, the truth, the life. He's the one we celebrate today on Easter Sunday and every day of our lives. Everyone who hears my voice right now, we are either in Peter's camp or we are in Judas Iscariot's camp. You see, we're either willing to walk with other believers as we cope with all the challenges of life, or we're going to try to do that on our own. We're going to try to cope with the challenges of life by drawing inward, trying to find within ourselves the resources. Guess what? It's not there. I don't have it. You don't have it. Nobody's got it inside themselves. We find it in Jesus. We need other human beings in order to cope with the challenges of being human, walking with Jesus. You know, we're not allowed to hold hands anymore, right? We're not allowed to gather together and share with one another the way we want to because of this nasty COVID-19. But you know, we got to stay connected. That's why we're doing this videotaping, as a way to try to stay connected. We can call each other, we can text each other, we can FaceTime each other. We got to find ways to stay connected. We must do everything we can to hear, see, and feel the presence of Jesus' Spirit in each of our lives. We must be encouraged to keep sharing the good news, right? Believe in ourselves and then share it. He is risen. He is Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for being the way, the truth, the life. Thank you that we have your word, Holy Scripture, to cling to in life. We have your Spirit, the Holy Spirit, to be with us and in us. We have each other. Lord, help us to not try to live this thing called life on our own. Help us acknowledge our need for each other. And just, we need to cling together and encourage one another. Certainly not condemn one another. Not create life any harder than it already is for one another. We are to love one another. We are to love each other as you loved us when you were here. So Lord, help us to bring glory to you. We pray in your precious name. Amen.